And welcome to the first of a special two-part edition of Delta Conveyance Deep Dive. According to the Delta Risk Management Strategy Report, published by DWR in 2009, there's a 1% annual probability that ground shaking during an earthquake near the western edge of the Delta could reach a level sufficient to cause levees to fail. That might not sound like a significant risk, but if it happened, the impacts on the state's water supply, the state water project, could be devastating. Here to help us understand why and how the proposed Delta Conveyance Project would help protect water supplies is Senior Engineer and Flood System Analyst Section Chief Laurence Sanati. Hi, Laurence. Welcome to Deep Dive.
Thanks, Pat. Happy to be here.
All right. So how would an earthquake affecting Delta levees potentially cause a major disruption to the state's water supply? Help us connect the dots here.
Well, Pat, that's a great question. And actually, there are a substantial amount of dots that need to be connected if we're going to fully grasp this complex scenario we as Californians find ourselves in. And I think to better understand the link between Delta levees and the state water supply, it'd be worthwhile to take a step back and make sure we understand the unique circumstances that really set up this very atypical relationship. And that relationship is largely the result of where California gets its water and where the water is needed. Now, I know at least a partial amount of this information has been covered in a previous deep dive, so I'm not gonna go into too much detail, but I do wanna make sure we have enough context so that we can appropriately frame our discussion today. So in California, 75% of our rain and snow falls in watersheds north of Sacramento. However, 80% of the state's water demand comes from the southern two-thirds of the state. So this obviously results in a dramatic mismatch on where the water is and where it's needed. So to address this mismatch, several water projects have been built in the early and mid-1900s, the two key projects being the Central Valley Project and State Water Project. Now, the key point here is that these projects, they accomplished an extremely impressive task of taking this vast amount of water and distributing it across hundreds of miles to the millions of Californians that need it. It's a crucial component of our ability to function as a state. Now, this large portion of water that resides in the north, it eventually makes its way south past Sacramento into the Sacramento-San Joaquin Delta. From there, it turns westward and begins mixing with the highly saline waters in the San Francisco Bay before it makes its way out to sea. So the Delta is really the southernmost point to naturally access this fresh water before it becomes essentially too saline to use any longer. For that reason, these projects draw their water from the southern end of the Delta and transport it to the millions of people that need it, as well as millions of acres of agriculture. So the waterways in the Delta are the actual physical link between the bulk of the state's water supply and its demand. Now, if these waterways were to become contaminated with salt water from the ocean, essentially severing that link, it would not just impact locals to the Delta, but also the 27 million people that depend on these projects for fresh water.
Thanks for that really good summary of California hydrology, but I still don't quite see the connection to the Delta levees. Aren't the Delta levees just meant to protect the land in the Delta from flooding? So how does that tie into the water supply?
Yeah, well, Pat, they certainly do protect the land in the Delta from flooding. However, if a Delta levee was to fail, as opposed to a levee somewhere else in the state, it brings with it an additional consequence beyond just what gets flooded. And once I explain this, hopefully I'll have kind of answered that initial question you've asked. And to help with this, I have a couple of graphics I'd like to throw on the screen. So what we have on the screen here is a satellite image of the Delta, which has been overlaid with this color contour that's meant to represent the level of salinity within the Delta channels. Now, I also have a few arrows on this screen. I have this large arrow at the top, which shows, is meant to indicate where the Sacramento flows enter the Delta. Now, this is, again, where that large volume of water that falls in the north enters into this unique region. There's also a small arrow down here to represent the San Joaquin River inflows. They also add fresh water to the Delta, but not nearly as substantial as the Sacramento River inflows. And then this third arrow down at the left, this is where these water projects draw their water from the Delta and export them out through our aqueducts to be distributed across the state. Now, This is somewhat of a normal condition that we'd expect to see in the Delta. This color contour of blue on the right side or the east side of the Delta is representative of relatively fresh water that we can generally export. And as you move westward, you start to get into this increasing salinity gradient as the water begins to mix with the saline waters in the bay until you get to the dark oranges and reds, which is pretty much ocean water. So under these conditions, you can see that these corridors are all covered in blue that actually connect this freshwater source in the north to the export facilities that deliver water to our water projects. One other thing to note on this image is that these tracts of land that are surrounded by these channels, which we refer to as Delta Islands, they have some interesting challenges to them. And what the issue is that over the years, roughly the last 150 years, they've experienced a substantial amount of subsidence. That is, the ground surface has been gradually lowering to a point where now in some areas, the water in the adjacent channel can be 20 feet above the land surface on the island itself, with only this levee preventing the water from rushing in and inundating this extremely large, almost bathtub-like void these islands create all throughout the Delta. Now, so if one of these islands was to breach, you'd have a situation like you see here, where on the left side of the screen, this is our Delta channel. We have this kind of in the center, this levee that has breached. And on the right side, this body of water that looks almost like an inland sea is actually an island that has flooded. And when this island here, it looks like it's pretty much full, but as it was initially flooding, there was a huge influx of water from the channel to the island as it began to fill. Now, if we have a situation where there's a seismic event and we have multiple islands fail, we run into a situation like this, where as these very large volumes of water are drawn from the channels, it pulls all the saline water from the San Francisco Bay to fill these islands, and additionally dispersing that saline water through the various channels and corridors in the Delta, creating this type of setup here, where now you can see that the saline water has penetrated deep eastward into the Delta, creating a situation where exports will need to be shut down until water quality can be restored to an acceptable level. Okay, now on the image here, you see that we still have this blue freshwater at the top where our northern sources are entering the Delta, but the link, that physical link that connects that northern freshwater to the export facilities, is blocked by all of these highly saline waters along the corridors themselves. So the last thing I want to show to just try to really help visualize this image, I have an animation that one of our modeling tools we've used to develop. And what I'm going to do here before I hit play, it's only a minute long. I'm just going to try to orient you to what you're looking at. I've set up a simulation here to try to evaluate what would happen if roughly 9 islands breached. Okay, I've chosen these islands arbitrary just to illustrate the phenomena that occurs. These blue islands are set to breach when I hit play. They're blue now, but they actually aren't breached. They will breach when we hit play. To orient you, on the left here, this is kind of the San Pablo Bay heading out to San Francisco Bay. And on the right, this is kind of the western side of the Delta. So let's go ahead and hit play and see how this works. There it goes. Now, this simulation is playing at about 1 day per second. So every second that goes by is about a 1 day of simulated actual time. And as you saw in the first maybe 3 to 5 seconds, there was this strong change and adjustment to this color contour as these islands filled and that saline water was drawn deep into the Delta. But then after those first few seconds, everything kind of stabilized. And you can see the simulation is actually still running. However, there's very little change in the color contour. What happens is once these islands fill, the Delta itself sort of falls into an equilibrium state where in the absence of strong inflows, the water in these channels and these islands that are highly saline, it's very challenging to get them out. So one thing to note here, these few corridors that are leading down on the right side of the screen, they're just north of that Clifton Court Forebay where the water projects export water. And you can see this green color here, that's representative of a salinity level about 10 times higher than we can actually export. The simulation has come to an end here and it ran for just about a minute, so roughly 60 days. So we can see even with this kind of moderate type event, 2 months after this event occurred, we're still at a point where we have salinity 10 times higher than we can export. I'm not gonna run this simulation all the way through to completion for you, but when I did, just to give you a level of magnitude of what type of impacts we can expect from these type of events, it took about 200 plus days to clear up this corridor to be fresh enough where we could resume exports. So hopefully, Pat, I've answered your initial question, and this helps illustrate this critical connection between Delta levees and the state's water supply.
So levee failures sound like a key trigger that could potentially force an outage of this critical water project and consequently disrupt the supply of water to millions of Californians. It sounds like we have an awful lot riding on these Delta levees. Can you tell us a little bit more about these Delta levees and any issues we should be aware of?
Actually, Pat, you're right. We do have an awful lot riding on these levees. And unfortunately, they're faced with some significant challenges. Much of the soil in the Delta, particularly along the western edge, is made up of this decomposed organic material we call peat soil. This soil is very fertile and naturally waterlogged. So what farmers have done is they've dug canals within the islands so that they could put pumps in the ground and draw the water out of the soil. And what that does is it brings the water table down so that agriculture can be sustained. The problem with that is that when you remove the water from this peat soil, it accelerates the decomposition of the organic carbon within the soil. And all that means is that the rate at which it decays is sped up, and the land essentially vaporizes. It turns into carbon dioxide gas. Now, this obviously takes a long time to occur, but over the decades since this region was initially settled, the land surface has been continually sinking. And as I've mentioned previously, in some areas, the land has dropped over 20 feet below its original point. And there are a couple of key issues associated with this. The first one we've already talked about. It creates these large voids that if there was a breach, it draws in the saline water from the bay. But in addition to that, it creates an additional array of stability issues for these levees. You can imagine if you have a structure and one side of it is continually lowering, that greatly increases the stress throughout the structure. And as a result, these levees have to be continually reinforced to maintain their stability. This is an ongoing challenge as subsidence continues within the Delta. Another key challenge is the fact that these levees are continuously hydraulically loaded. Now, to try to explain what that means, if you've ever been out to the American River or Sacramento River during summer, you go down to the river in the channel and you can look behind you and you see the levee far off in the distance and it's all dry. There's no water touching it. But then during winter, when we have large storm events, the water swells out of the channel and presses up against these levees, and these levees do their job confining the water within the channel, preventing the outside areas from getting inundated. And that can last for a day or a few weeks, but when the storm passes, the water eventually subsides and goes back into the channel, and the levees are dry. This is a more common application of a levee where they're intermittently hydraulically loaded, and sometimes quite sparsely, as these type of storm events don't happen every year necessarily. But that's a stark contrast to what we see in the Delta. When you're driving along a Delta levee and you look over the side, there is water there 365 days a year. This essentially makes these levees more of dams rather than levees, where they're continually hydraulically loaded. And with that comes a myriad of issues. They experience a lot of seepage issues and boils as this hydraulic force is trying to push the water through the soil matrix. In addition to the hydraulic loading, the material of which these levees have been constructed, it's mostly this uncompacted weak soil, which was locally attained, which makes sense because when they were constructing these levees initially, they used what was around them and convenient. But the issue there is that these soils have a great amount of sand and silt, and that's within the levee prism itself as well as the foundation. And if we experience strong enough ground accelerations, liquefaction could occur. Now, that just means that if we have an earthquake, the levees could potentially lose their strength and stiffness to a point where it behaves more like a liquid than a solid. And that's a pretty scary thought when you consider the amount of water they're holding back. And I suppose finally, just as if these challenges weren't enough for the levees, when you consider the Delta's proximity to active faults in the Bay Area, we begin to realize the very fragile nature of this conveyance system we rely on so heavily.
So Laurence, what would the state do if an event like this occurred?
So this issue is obviously something that we're well aware of, and we've been planning and strategizing on how to address for a long time now. We've developed many detailed plans to kind of guide our response and recovery efforts. We've built some enormous stockpiles of rock, material, and steel that can be used to basically be distributed throughout the Delta to repair these potential breaches should they occur. We have equipment in place that can load these materials onto barges and transport them to where they're needed. In addition to that, we've also spent a lot of effort in developing some very sophisticated modeling tools that help us evaluate the impacts of a specific event after it occurs. And in addition to that, these tools can help evaluate the strategies we want to put in place to kind of optimize our response and minimize the impacts to the state water supply. And then all of these aspects that I've mentioned, we conduct trainings and exercises to regularly to make sure that we have a sharpened response. And should this occur, we're ready to act. So it's been, you know, over the last 10 years, we've really put in a significant amount of effort to really bolster our capability to respond to a large catastrophic event in the Delta. And we could easily fill a full deep dive video on how we would respond to that. But I think the key points here are, we're very well prepared should a potential catastrophic event occur. We have the tools and plans in place to really guide our response, and in some cases, greatly reduce the impacts to our water supply. However, to implement these response actions, it can be costly, it takes time, and for a big enough event, regardless of how well we're prepared, we could still experience a significant disruption to our water supply.
So Laurence, how does the Delta Conveyance Project fit in with this?
Well, Pat, when I think of the Delta Conveyance Project, it actually reminds me of an analogy I heard a while back. The analogy wasn't really related to the project, but it's surprisingly fitting. Now, suppose you have a cliff that represents a hazard where people could potentially fall off and get injured. There are two ways to address this hazard. One way is we could develop a very robust emergency response system. We could have ambulances strategically pre-positioned. We could have very well-trained medical staff that could quickly triage and rapidly transport the injured to the hospital. You know, whoever fell would receive top-notch treatment in a very efficient manner, okay? The other way we could address this hazard is we could put a rail at the top of the cliff so people won't fall off in the first place. So in terms of the Delta, we can continue to develop and invest in our ability to more effectively respond to a catastrophic failure to our water supply system. Now, or we could put this rail at the top of the cliff, right? What that means is we could build a seismically resilient tunnel that would preserve that crucial link between where water is and where it's needed and avoid the hazard in the first place. And in my humble opinion, one of these two options is just the obvious choice. Now, that said, I'm very proud of all the effort that we've put into our response and preparation for an event like this. And I'm confident this preparation will result in a reduced disruption to our water supply should this event occur. And, you know, considering the current state of the Delta and everything we talked about today, these emergency response efforts and preparations are essential. But if we can solve the problem by removing the hazard, which in my understanding is the objective of this Delta Conveyance Project, well, in my opinion, it's better to remove a hazard rather than to try and mitigate it once it's occurred.
Well, thanks very much, Laurence, for that very informative look at how a major earthquake in or near the Delta could affect the state's water supply. It is an alarming scenario to contemplate. So thanks for joining us today.
My pleasure, Pat. Thank you very much for having me.
And in part two, we will hear from two prominent earthquake experts about how the specific geology of the Delta gives state water managers additional cause for concern about the resilience of the levees and what it is that makes the proposed Delta tunnel a viable earthquake-resistant option for moving water through the Delta. I hope you will join us then. Thank you for watching.